hey, man, what's up? It is the Ace Michaels Show. And just for the record, they were dancing, and they were singing, and they were moving to the grooving. And just when it hit me, somebody turned around and said, play that funky music, white boy. And they did. They laid down the boogie till they died. And if you're watching the show today, you know that to be true. You can share that information with friends and family. And you can also consider being on the show. That way you can come on and speak your mind, ideas, voice your opinions, suggestions, convictions, beliefs, prophecies, fears. You know who you are. And we'd love to have you on the show. Thank you for making us number one on your social media. And let's jump right into it. Today, my guest is a first-timer to the show. She's new here. We're going to go light on her. Ruby Lewis is on the Ace Michaels Show today. Ruby, welcome to the show.
Howdy do. Thank you for having me.
I am so honored. I've been following your work for a while.
Get out.
You're singing it as well. I caught up with you on the beginning of the Marilyn show, when you first started promoting the Marilyn show.
Mm-hmm.
And when you see stuff like that, to me, I'm always challenged to say, who does this think they look like Marilyn Monroe? You better not look like no Marilyn Monroe. Let me look at this girl. She do look like Marilyn Monroe. Wow.
I had an amazing hair and makeup team, to be fair.
But you do look like Marilyn Monroe.
I can see it. Yeah, I find resemblances now. I never would have said that prior to the show, though.
So when you auditioned, did you think you looked like Marilyn Monroe?
No. It wasn't until the makeup team, it was incredible how they even changed the shape of my nose a little bit. They changed kind of my jaw a little bit, all you know, stage makeup. But once that happened and I saw the photographs, I couldn't believe it.
Why did you do the show?
Well, I was approached by my dear friend Tegan Summer. He was working with the Marilyn Monroe Estate, and I was doing a show here called Baz at the Palazzo, and I thought to work with the Marilyn Monroe Estate would be incredible, and to take on that role would be an incredible challenge, and the opportunity as an actress would have been awesome. So I kind of just went full-fledged into it, and I got to know her very well. I felt like she was even there with me on opening night. It was June 1st is her birthday. We opened that night, and I swear to God, I could feel her presence. So I got really close with her.
Wow.
It was cool.
It would seem like if you're doing a show of someone's life, it would seem incredibly daunting. Like, were you a little afraid? Like, what if I misstep in some way? What if I say something that someone from the audience and go, she don't talk like that? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, there were going to be critics, I knew. But what I really focused on in my preparation was just her heart. I mean, she was so gracious and truly humble, and she was an activist. And so I just tried to capture in every moment. If I didn't quite get her voice right, which her Marilyn voice was put on by her as well. So,
right, so then you've got to impersonate someone who's impersonating.
Right. But we decided also, the creative team and myself, we decided that once I broke into song, it was me. It was Ruby's voice coming through. And then in a lot of the scene work, I would drop back into, or in, I guess, raise back up into her voice.
Now, what kind of research do you do for a role like this?
Just a lot of, I read a lot of literature. I watched a lot of interviews that she did, some just lost footage. And then one of my favorites, I think it was P.S., it was something on HBO, a documentary where they read through some of her diaries. They had a lot of celebrities come through and read some of her diary entries, and to me, that was the true entry into who she was and what her values were, and, you know, she just wanted to be loved and to love. It was really simple.
Wow. Now, Ruby, you know, I talk to a lot of people who might be considered knuckleheads by other people, so... A lot of the people that I talk to, they say stuff like, well, acting is easy, anybody can be an actor, blah, 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 blah. So I want to ask you, how important is training as an actor? Like, how much of it is really hard work?
It's really hard work to get out of your head and to drop into the psyche of another being. I mean, that's what acting is. And also observation of other people. So I consider myself... you know, I observe behavior all day long, and I'm just kind of putting it in my trunk of different idiosyncrasies that, you know, it's like if I haven't experienced, for instance, drug abuse, but I have to play a role, someone who's, you know, addicted to drugs, how do I tap into that? And it's just a lot of observation. But then also, it's, you know, you have to be able to commit to it so fully that it's believable, and that's the hard part, and that's what takes practice, I think.
Now, is Ruby Lewis at the point where she can play anything? Like, can you play anything now?
Yes.
You can play anything?
I think with enough time and help, I can.
Can you play Superman? Can you play Superman and Batman?
Yeah, sure.
You could play Superman and Batman for real?
I mean...
Now, Ruby, don't toy with my emotions, girl. I'm serious. No, can you play... You can play Superman... And then conversely play Batman.
You know what?
The director
I think we
you.
Should pitch this idea to the CW.
Nah, don't mess it up. Trust me, don't mess it up. But yeah. Anyway, that's a whole fanboy thing. But yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you could play anything, though, at this point.
I could play my version of anything. I think so. I mean, I think so much is dependent on, like I said, hair, makeup, costuming. Mm. That, to me, once I have all that on, it helps me so much to channel
that
character.
Make you feel the character then? Once mm-hmm. you put that, once you see yourself in that makeup, do you go, okay, now I'm
yep.
whoever the character
mm-hmm,
is?
Mm-hmm. And it makes it my guard's down then, because I'm no longer Ruby. And that's why I've had a little bit of trouble performing just as myself in a cabaret setting or even as a recording artist, because I like to be behind the guys. I like to mm-hmm, mm-hmm. you know, be behind, underneath the wig, so to speak. Just makes me feel more comfortable.
You know, it's interesting. I wasn't doing it in preparation for this interview. It just happened last night. I watched Rocket Man, the mm-hmm. Elton John biopic. And it wasn't really surprising to me that Elton John was very happy playing characters on stage. He felt more comfortable playing this character. And of course, Elton John is a pseudonym. But what was interesting to me was that it was completely accepted by people.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in this generation, I don't know that that's accepted by people as much. Like, we're in a very reality-tinged mm-hmm. generation. Whereas the 60s and 70s, it was okay to become a character. You know, you could be Alice Cooper.
Sure.
And people would accept it. You could be Kiss. You could be Meatloaf and be this larger-than-life thing that mm-hmm. clearly wasn't real. And people knew David Lee Roth didn't really live that life. He couldn't possibly live that life,
mm-hmm.
but it was exciting for people. Whereas now it's all about, you know, rappers are real. This is real. I'm really a gangster, and
right.
I'm really going out and shooting people when I'm not cashing my $1 million checks.
Right.
So where do you, as an artist, where do you draw the line between what's real and what's not? Like, when you work on your albums, how much of what you write is real Ruby versus
right.
the persona?
Well, I cannot write if it's not honest. But where I've found I can stray is using, like, personification and using metaphor and stuff. So a lot of my songs, they may sound like a love song, but I actually wrote the song about a stargazer lily in my kitchen that died and I was sad, type of thing.
Mm.
So it's like I'm trying to pull, I'm being honest about what I'm saying, but I'm using a lot of metaphor, like I said, because I haven't been through everything, I haven't experienced everything, but I like to have a rich voice. And then I like to just keep it real, like in my real life with activism and, you know, just trying to stay on the scene, trying to stay on the beat, make sure, you know, what I have, If you know, I do happen to have a platform one day that's larger than life, then I want to set myself up to where I'm really making a difference and not just mm-hmm. barking words and making young kids believe they need plastic surgery.
Do you ever find yourself saying, let's say there was a certain incident happened at a wishing well and now it's public news and it's a big story all over the country, do you ever find yourself saying, you know what, that doesn't belong in Ruby's music. Like, I am a woman, but there's certain things I don't need to say about being a woman in my
mm-hmm.
song.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that I consider myself kind of the every woman. I don't know if it's a Southern thing, but, you know, I'm a tomboy. I can rough and tumble. I'm also incredibly sensitive, but I think men should and can be incredibly
sensitive.
Yeah. Right. Well, this is one of my...
If a tomboy looks like this...
This is one of my alter egos, the ruffle dress. That's not normally my gig,
the ruffle
gig,
dress is a cute thing. That's definitely Southern.
Yeah.
And where are you from in the South?
Yeah, I'm from Kentucky.
Kentucky?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
We're dealing with some issues in Louisville right now that I'm not too proud of.
And are you from a big Kentucky family? You got like 20 kids,
I had
brothers
a lot
and sisters?
I had a lot of siblings, not all full siblings, but it was a full house. There are 5 of us total.
Okay.
And, you know, older siblings, so we weren't always in the house together, but now we're all still very close, and I'm really thankful for that.
And so what is the story of Ruby Lewis coming from Kentucky, and you've lived in Las Vegas, mm-hmm. and you've done work in L.A.? I mean, you've mm-hmm. done the American dream.
It's been amazing, and I have to honestly say it's just been one thing led to another, and I just kind of keep taking the steps, and I keep trusting that that's the direction I need to go in. I stayed in Kentucky for college, got my musical theater degree, but I had auditioned in New York City in the spring, and I booked my first national tour.
Nice.
And it was a bus and truck tour. It was gypsy, non-equity, but I did not know the difference, and I did not care. And I just hopped on that bus, and for 9 months, we did one-nighters around the country. And then, you know, I said, I love this.
So talk to me about success for a second, because you're clearly successful. But where does the success come from for Ruby? Is it that you've been this successful because of your faith, that you read the Bible every day, or has it been luck? Would you say, hey, sometimes it just works out? Or are you the person who is doing all of the preparation in advance and knowing which parties to go to and which people to get to know? Like, what would you mm-hmm. consider is the main component of Ruby Lewis' success?
That's deep.
It is deep.
You know, I believe that God graced me with my gifts for a reason, and that it's my duty to use them. And I have always trusted that that has been the case, because singing and performing has come so naturally to me since I was really young. I started singing in church when I was 2. And
I can see a little Ruby Lewis, 2-year-old.
Mm-hmm, like this
church,
little light
no
of
shoes
mine.
On,
yeah.
A peanut butter sandwich in one hand, doll with a broken arm in the other one. Yeah, I see it.
I had to be polished. My mother was not going to let me out of there with a tear in my tights or anything like that.
Nothing like that.
Shine on my shoes and
so
stuff.
So little Ruby was a church girl singing in the church.
Oh, yes.
Nice.
All through high school even, I was in church band when, you know, we're just singing the worship songs. And that's how I found my voice, much like Whitney, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't compare myself to Whitney at all, but I do know that, you know, being granted that gift to grow up in a church family where you can just sing and you sing your heart out, it's wonderful.
Do you think people can make it without spirituality, without being grounded in faith? You think somebody can still be successful in children?
I guess it's your definition of make it, but I think make money, yes. Hmm. You know, and I get a little thrown off when I see people who I wouldn't consider noble reach a good degree of financial success. It kind of, I'm like, man, I don't want to wish ill on anybody, but it's like taking advantage of people along the way, lying, cheating, you know, stealing, whatever it takes, and then they do make it, and I'm like, dang, that just really goes against my ideologies.
Right.
But that's the world we live in. It's free, you know, capitalist society. So I'm willing to play the game, and I'm going to play it fair.
And so what's on your end game list? So you've had a show mm-hmm. on the Strip, which is that's a career goal. Some people never achieve that.
Mm-hmm.
So you've had a show on the Strip, you star in the show, and you've won awards as well.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the end game? What is next for Ruby?
Well, I'd like another shot. I had my Broadway debut already, and then that was one of my big goals. But I would really like to be involved in a Broadway show that is super successful and that changes society, like Hamilton.
Right, right, okay.
You know,
okay.
I love collaboration, and I love being involved in projects that create change.
Nice.
And I'd also like to win a Tony Award.
Throw that in there.
Yeah, why not? But ultimately, I just love to live my life as an artist and to be able to build a platform that is large enough to just have outreach. I mean, I really believe I can reach a lot of people if I had the right platform.
Do you feel that artists have a responsibility to their art that they put out? Like, you know, you're a rapper, you know you reach millions of people, don't go saying something dumb on your record that's gonna get people riled up. Say something intelligent.
Yes.
So you think, you believe that artists do have a responsibility?
Well, I believe it is, the other responsibility is to voice the frustrations and, you know, and what's going on in society, and to be the voice of the people. And if there is a lot of anger, you know, the artist can speak out for those people. Mm-hmm. But I think yin and yang, like, also be available and capable of providing a message of healing and finding solutions. That, to me, it's only if it's one-sided and it's just spewing out, you know, anger and hate, and there's not any, there's no solution, then to me it sounds like you're not doing your job.
Mm-hmm. So think about that. I love that answer, by the way. Think about this before you answer. This is the last question I'll get to ask because we're going to run out of time.
Okay.
But think about this. I just won two tickets to go see Ruby Lewis perform at the Troubadour. In your opinion, what's the best thing about what I'm going to see that night?
I think you're going to have a theatrical experience. Yeah. I think you're not going to know at all what to expect going in, and you're going to leave feeling like you were transported into another world.
Wow.
That's what I'm going for.
Well, I can't change that, and I can't close the show on a stronger note than that. It's been the Ace Michael Show. Guys, live the life you love. Love the life you live.
Amen.
Thank you, Ruby.
Thanks for having
That's
me.
Awesome.
Claire.